Okie dokie, I think we are live once again. So hello everyone, welcome back to another edition of Quarantine Thermo. Today we're very pleased to welcome Dr. Álvaro Alhambra from the Perimeter Institute. So before I kind of hand over to him, as usual, I'm just going to briefly recap the sort of format of this seminar series. So Álvaro is basically going to speak for however long he wants, I guess about 45 minutes, uninterrupted. And then we'll have questions and answers at the end. So if you have any questions during the talk or after the talk, please just write them in the YouTube chat window and I'll relay them to Álvaro. I think basically that's it. So I'll hand over to Álvaro. He's going to be telling us about some really interesting recent work on work extraction. So the title of the talk is CP Local Passivity, Fundamental Limitations to Local Energy Extraction. So please go ahead, Álvaro, you can share a screen.
Okay, thanks a lot, Mark. I guess I'll do this now. Okay, can you see the full screen? Okay, can you see it? No? Okay, good. So first of all, thanks a lot, Mark, and the rest of the team for setting these seminars up. I think it's quite a useful resource to have in the community. And I'm very happy to have the opportunity to present this work, which we put out a few months ago. And it's in collaboration with a few people, mostly a team based around Waterloo. So Yorgos Tiliaris is not Waterloo, but he was visiting Waterloo when we were working on this. He's a student at Southern California. Nayeli, who's a student at IQC. Jamie, who's a colleague of mine at the Perimeter Institute. We're both postdocs there. And Eduardo, who's a prof at IQC and University of Waterloo. Okay, so let me just start the talk now. So actually, I want to start in a slightly unorthodox way by starting with the conclusions, no? With the take-home messages of this talk, because there's a couple of ideas that I want to just get across everyone, and you know, hopefully I can convince you of them. The first one is a proposal, and the proposal is that the usual notion of passivity, which probably most of you know already, but I'm also going to explain it a bit, maybe extended to further similar notions, in particular maybe thought of as part of a larger class of kinds of passivity. And the point I want to get across is that some of these notions may be interesting and physically relevant. And as far as our results are concerned, what we do is we characterize one such notion, which we think is interesting. And this notion is based on local CPT maps, CPTP maps. Okay, so for this, we used a couple of quantum information inspired techniques, and I also want to like talk a bit about them because I think they may be interesting for this kind of problem and potentially also for other problems in quantum thermo. One of them is semi-definite programming, which is a very standard tool in quantum information, but I don't know how many people in this community know about it, so I also sort of want to advertise it a bit, and also some properties of quantum thermal states. I'll go over this in detail. And the last thing I have is a question for all of you, which is that we have a phenomenon, no? And this phenomenon looks a bit like a quantum limitation to energy exchanges. So my question is whether this can also be thought of as a limitation for quantum thermal machines. I'll go over this later, and you know, maybe you can tell me if this idea makes sense or not. Okay, so I'll just start with talking about passivity. So I guess passivity is one of the central ideas of, or more important, like concepts of quantum thermodynamics. No, it's behind like some statements of a second law, and like it's very related to work extraction from quantum systems and so on. So it's quite important. No, so let me just explain it in detail. I'm going to be talking about passivity, not defined as something as a property of a state, but as a property of a state and Hamiltonian together. Okay, so the pair rho and h is passive. So the question is, when is the pair rho and h passive? Well, it is passive when no energy can be extracted from the state via some unitary process U. Okay, so the definition of it exactly, like mathematically, I want to write it in this form, this formal definition that I talk about now. No? So this pair is passive if and only if this quantity is zero. So what is this quantity? This quantity is the energy after the unitary minus the energy before the unitary, and I optimize over all unitaries. You know. So what is the smallest energy that a state can have after the unitary? No? Well, it's this, no? And if this is zero, it means that no unitary can decrease the energy of my state. And this is equivalent to the usual condition, no? Which is that if you know a state is passive, if it commutes with the Hamiltonian, and also if the populations are ordered in like from largest to smallest. No? So basically, this is the task that we have here is trying to extract energy with our restricted set of quantum maps, and these quantum maps are happen to be unitary in this case, no? So actually, let me mention another kind of passivity that you can think about, which is passivity for general CPTP maps. Okay. So now what I've done is I've written the same expression, but the optimization is over a larger set of maps, which are all CPTP maps, so all possible quantum maps, no? Okay, so you can ask, what is the analog of passivity here? Well, I mean, this is kind of very simple, no? Because of course, this quantity, you can calculate it straight away, no? Because of course, the map that minimizes this number is the map that takes any state to the ground state of the Hamiltonian, right? So this quantity is always gonna be this, the energy of the ground state minus the initial energy. So this is zero, if and only if your initial state is the ground state, right? So of course, this is like not a very interesting kind of passivity because only the ground state is pretty trivially passive in this sense, no? Like, it seems that there's really nothing interesting here, no? But, you know, it's an example of, like, a similar structure, no? So, you know, one can ask the question of, like, you know, what about other restrictions on CPTP maps, no? And actually, this allows you to write a little chart, right, of different types of passivity, no? And these different types of passivity are basically, they're defined as different restrictions on maps, right? And then you can ask the question of, is this restriction interesting or is it not, okay? And then some of them will be, some of them will not, no? So the restriction I was talking about first is unitary maps. And of course, we know this is very interesting because this is like, it's very important in quantum thermodynamics. There's another notion, which is this CPTP passivity. This is not interesting because, you know, we see it's very trivial. But there's other constraints you can put, no? So I want to focus in this talk on local constraints, no? So for instance, one can think of a kind of local passivity where the unitaries are only allowed to act on half of our bipartite system, right? So this is a setting that has been, I mean, this setting and similar ones have been studied before in the community, and maybe not in exactly these terms, but actually I think maybe this review, which is one of the chapters of the quantum thermodynamics book, has some information about this in case you're interested. But I don't want to talk about this. What I want to talk about instead is a different notion, which I think has been studied very little, which is a notion in which you have CPTP maps, but again, they're only allowed to act on half of your system, no? So on, you know, you have a bipartite system, which is A and B, Alice and Bob, and you can only act on half of it, no? On Alice, no? So this is gonna be the subject of this talk. And hopefully, you know, I didn't write anything here because hopefully I managed to convince you that this notion is interesting, no? That's kind of my plan for this talk. Okay, so let's just start talking about this more in little detail of the CPTP setting of what I'm gonna be calling this CP local passivity, which can be understood as local cooling, no? So I want to talk about the setting and also the intuition of why this may be relevant. So the setting is basically one in which we have two systems that are coupled by a Hamiltonian. So you have local Hamiltonians and then you have the coupling, no? And imagine, for instance, like a 1D chain, no? And the restriction that I put is that I want to act on this subsystem A with any CPTP map such that I extract energy, no? So what is the intuition behind this? So imagine that because this Hamiltonian is strongly coupled, the eigenstates are gonna be entangled, right? In particular, the low energy subspace is gonna have entanglement, right? For instance, the ground state, no? And the cooling means approaching the ground state in a sense, no? So cooling locally means that you are approaching the ground state or some entangled state with local operations. And we know that this is impossible, no? Because of course, entangled state cannot be generated by local operations, no? So this is more or less the intuition of why there's something non-trivial going on here, no? Like basically there's gonna be a point at which these local maps are not gonna be able to cool any further, right? And this intuitively may have to do with entanglement in your low energy thermal state, for instance, no? So there should be limitations coming from this interplay. And some motivations for studying this are, you know, motivations that people have in quantum thermodynamics, like for instance, studying the relations between quantum correlations or any kind of correlations and energy flows, no? This is an active topic of study. And this is also connected to like the interplay of entanglement and control at low temperatures. And again, I want to repeat the question I had in the beginning, which is, you know, Can we relate this effect to quantum thermal machines, right? That work at, you know, at fast and in a strongly coupled regime and at low temperature. Okay. So let me just repeat the question one more. once more. So the question is, are there non-trivial situations in which for any CPTP map, a local CP map on Alice, no energy can be extracted from the whole system with Hamiltonian HAV? So the answer is yes. And actually, this was not shown by us. This was shown first by this paper, which I want to give a lot of credit to, actually, this paper of Frey, Fun, and Hota. It's the paper where they talk about this kind of passivity for the first time, and they have some basically the intuition of why it happens. And the problem is that they didn't have very explicit constructions or proofs, so we just sort of improve on the result technically, let's say. But the idea was already here. No? Okay, so let me rephrase the question again. So CP local passivity is the question of when is the pair rho h such that this quantity is zero, right? That's what we're going to be studying in this talk. Basically, characterizing the conditions under which this equation is true. Okay, so as results, we have necessary and sufficient conditions. Sufficient conditions highlighting the role of ground state entanglement, and also some bounds that work on many body systems, on thermal states of many body systems, which we think are like a particularly relevant place where this may be an interesting effect. Okay. So yes, I just want to rewrite this equation once more, and now I want you to look at this in a different way. No, what is this? This is an optimization over a set of channels. Okay. And the question we want to ask to this optimization is, when is the solution of the optimization given by the identity channel, right? Because of course, the identity channel is always a valid candidate for this optimization, no? And if the identity channel is the minimum, then this quantity is zero, no? So that's what we want to ask, no? When is this is going to minimize overall channels, and our question is, when is the minimum the identity channel, okay? And if the minimum is the identity channel, then you know this state and Hamiltonian are CP local passive, okay? It turns out that this question is actually very easy to answer with the right framework. And I want to explain the framework now. The framework is semi-definite programming. Semi-definite programming is just like a mathematical tool. And you can write it in a slightly general form. It's basically a set of optimization problems, no? And these optimization problems take this general form, okay? So you're optimizing over some set X, right? And you want to optimize a linear function of X. No? In this case, I can write it as trace of Cx, where C is some matrix. And the key thing here is that X has to be subject to some constraints that are linear. So a constraint, for instance, may take this form, where this is a linear map on X, and B is some matrix. And another constraint is that X has to be positive, semi-definite. Right? This is the usual setting of semi-definite programs. This is very useful in quantum information because this covers pretty much all the problems that have to do with optimizations over quantum states, POVMs, also quantum channels, by something called the Choi-Yamilkowski isomorphism, which basically maps the problem of quantum channels to the problem of quantum states or bipartite quantum states. And this is like a very, very well-known tool. It's extremely useful in quantum information. It's been used like for many years already. And for a good reference, if you want to learn more about it, is the book of John Watrous. And probably many of you have already heard of this in some form, but I just wanted to to advertise this a little bit. No? And this is a very well-known framework, and many things are known about it. And of course, this in particular, we want to ask a question to this framework, okay? Which is, when is a particular feasible solution X star the optimal one, right? So given the constraints of my problem, which here are, for instance, C and B, I want to ask, what are the conditions on C and B such that a particular solution X star is the optimal one, right? So this is actually an old problem, and this was first addressed in like these papers from the 70s, which have to do with state discrimination. And in this case, the semi-definite program took this form. No? You have a bunch of quantum states, rho mu. Mu is like the index of quantum states. And you want to be able to distinguish them very well with some given POVM. Okay, so the quantity you want to optimize is like the probability of guessing the right state correctly. No? So you have the state, you measure it with your POVM. You want to guess which state you're given correctly. No? So you can optimize this and obtain like the optimal POVM, but also you can ask, for a given set of states, when is a particular POVM optimal? No? And it turns out that the solution to this problem is simple. It takes the form of an operator inequality, which is of this form, right? So you can see that the things that come in here are the states, which are the input to your problem. So here the states are going to be like the equivalent of C. And also the, you know, if the, so if the P of M E of mu satisfies this inequality, then you know that is the optimal, okay? So we can do exactly the same as they, as these people did, but for our problem, no? And, you know, we obtain the solution. So our problem is this one again, no? It's an optimization over channels. And then, okay, so let me explain the solution a bit in detail. It's possible I'm going to be a bit fast over this, but as long as you get more or less the idea of what's going on, that's fine. Not all the details are important here. Okay, so what is the solution? So I want to write this operator, which is C of A prime. A prime is a subsystem it's like a virtual subsystem that you have for convenience, basically. And it's like a copy of the Hilbert space of A, okay? So I have this operator, which is defined on A prime, and it's a function of rho and h, right? So you can see that rho of AB and h of A prime B, so they have support in different Hilbert spaces. And I take the partial transpose on A of this on the state, and I just take the trace and trace over B, okay? So you can see that, I mean, basically all you need to know about this operator is that it's a function of rho and h, and it has support on A prime, okay? And then there's another operator which I want to define, which is just this thing here. And this is nothing but the Choi-Yamalkowski state corresponding to the identity channel. And I mean, for those of you who don't know what it is, this is basically just an unnormalized maximally entangled state. So a bunch of Bell pairs without the normalization. So it's not a quantum state. It's the trace of this thing is one, actually. Okay, so with these things, we can write the condition of when a particular pair of rho and h is CP local passive, and it's this, it takes this form. It's not very intuitive, but I'll just explain it quickly. It's just an operator inequality like the previous one, okay? So we have this C operator, and the constraint is that this has to be larger than this other thing, which you can see is a function of C again, and the Choi-Yamalkowski state of the identity channel. This is just a, you know, maximal entangled state. So, you know, you can see that if you know rho and h, you can compute this very easily. You just do this like small manipulations, and you know you can plug this in the computer, and you can check whether this operator inequality is true. And if it's true, then you know that your pair rho and h is CP local passive. No, so this checking this is similar to checking whether your state commutes with your Hamiltonian and has like decreasing energy populations in the energy eigenbasis. No? So this is equivalent to that condition in the case of CP local passivity. No. Okay, and maybe to give some intuition about this condition, I'm going to show you one direction of the proof, the if direction, okay? So let's start with the operator inequality, and I'm just going to do a couple of manipulations, and hopefully it's not too fast. First, I'm just going to multiply both sides with an operator EAA prime. This operator is going to be the Choi-Yamalkowski operator of any quantum channel, of an arbitrary quantum channel. So just think that this operator just represents a quantum channel, okay? That is going to be like a given quantum channel that I use to extract the energy, you know? And then I take the trace. Okay, so I can manipulate the right side a little bit. And you see that this operator has trivial support on A prime. So this means that I can actually write this thing as this. So I can divide the trace, you know, into A and A prime. So I can, you know, I can take first the trace of A prime and then the trace of an A. And this simplifies in the sense that now I'm taking the trace of A prime of this operator. And the thing is that by definition, because this is the Choi-Yamalkowski operator of a channel, this is the identity. Okay. So I can just simplify all this thing. You know, this basically goes away. And I get this thing, which is the trace of the Choi-Yamalkowski operator for the identity channel with this C of AA prime. And this is not gonna be obvious, but the thing is that by definition, this quantity is the energy after the local map has been applied, and this is the energy before the local map is applied, right? So what's happened here is that we've shown that from this operator inequality, the energy after applying the local map must be larger or equal than the energy before the map. So you cannot decrease the energy by applying local maps. Okay. And and you can see how, you know, and basically this means that the pair of CP is CP local passive, no? Of course, one problem that we have here is that the condition is not very intuitive, no? It's kind of very abstract, no? So I want to spend some time just talking about particular cases that maybe, you know, so this doesn't tell you whether there's physically relevant cases where this happens, no? So I want to talk a bit more about this point in particular, no? That there in fact exist cases where this is where this thing happens, no? In a physically relevant setting, no? First, I actually, before moving into that, I just want to talk about a small caveat. So I've been talking about how this thing is related to entanglement, no? in the energy eigenbasis and in the low energy eigenspace, no? I just want to like have a caveat, which is that actually this can happen in classical situations too, you know. But I want to say that it happens in a way that is sort of trivial, no? In the same sense as the CPTP passivity was trivial, no? So imagine you have a Hamiltonian in which the whole eigenbasis is product eigenbasis. And the state, and also the state is separable, okay? So what we know actually is that local control can always decrease the energy. And I mean, we read this a bit more carefully in the paper. Here I'm not being very careful with what I mean with these things. But hopefully I get the point across. So local control can always decrease the energy. Local CPTP maps can always decrease the energy unless we have states like this. And what is this? This is like, you have, for instance, a Hamiltonian that is H of A plus H of B, no? No interaction, and you have A on the ground state. Of course, you cannot extract any energy, no, because like you're already in the ground state, no. So, and there's other situations that are similar to this due to the degeneracy, no. So actually, we know that in a sense. I mean, this is like almost the simplest case, no. But basically, any classical situation looks a bit like this, no. And in fact, we know that no classical thermal state at a finite temperature, or indeed any state of full rank, is CP local passive, no. So thermal states of this Hamiltonian, you can always extract energy locally, no? Always. Only when you have quantum correlations in the eigenstates, this thing appears, no? This we know for sure. And this is useful because I think thermal states are the ones for which you know this kind of phenomenon may be more interesting actually. I have to clarify that of course with the usual notion of passivity. Thermal states are passive, but thermal states are not necessarily CP local passive. Let me just clarify that. And in fact, I'm going to be talking about thermal states for the rest of the talk. Okay, so now we have some results about the role of ground state entanglement in this phenomenon. Okay, so the question we asked ourselves after we had this necessary insufficient condition is, you know, when can we actually expect this thing to appear? No, in which simple cases? No. And in fact, we had the intuition also coming from the paper of Frey, Funon, Jota, that the ground state entanglement played some role. No, so we have a result about this. So imagine now we have a setting in which we have a Hamiltonian of A and B, where now the states are entangled, can be entangled, and in particular the ground state can be written in this way. No, so this is like the Smith decomposition of the ground state. So these Qi are the Smith coefficients of the ground state. Maybe I should have written square root here actually. So the Smith coefficients of the ground state. And now we have a state, rho AB, that is diagonal in the energy eigenbasis, okay? This is just a constraint we impose. Okay, so the result we have is that if the ground state probability on this state is large enough, then this state is CP local passive, no? And we have a bound on this. So you see this number here, okay? So this number is important. I want to stop on it for a second. So P0 is the ground state population of this state, okay? And this number, in general, is going to be smaller than 1, okay? So what I'm saying is that if the ground state population is larger than this number, that is smaller than 1, if it's 1, if this is trivial, then your state is CP local passive, no? So now what we want to know is when is this number smaller than 1, no? Well, it's going to be smaller than 1 when this thing here is larger than 0, right? And this thing has a few things in it, no? So this E1 minus E0 is the gap of your Hamiltonian. It's the difference between the ground state and the first excited state. This thing is the difference between the highest excited state and the ground state. So this can be quite large. So we don't want this to be very large, actually. And this thing here is actually the smallest Smith coefficient of the ground state. So you take all these numbers and you take the smallest. So we can see that this bound is non-trivial when this is not very large, when this is not very small, and when this is not very small, no? So, but, you know, this may be something that happens in ground states, no? because in particular, if you have a if your marginal on A has full rank, this quantity is non-zero, and this will be non-zero, no? So this is just a particular situation where this CP local passivity can appear, no? And you can see that entanglement plays an important role, no? Let's examine this a bit more. When do we expect this bound to be relevant? First of all, when the region A is small, because otherwise this actually decreases very fast. So think of like a qubit or a couple of qubits, no? Also, because you need this quantity to be non-zero, you need a unique unentangled ground state. And actually, we know that from this paper of Dawson and Nielsen, we know that for these two things to happen at the same time, some frustration is needed in the Hamiltonian. And the other thing is that this quantity in the denominator cannot be too large, because otherwise it blows up, no? And actually, well, we know actually that this one, we can prove that, we can get rid of this one, actually. I'll explain to you how in a second. And actually, one thing I want to say about this bound is that it's basically the best thing we could prove, but it's definitely possible to improve it a lot but with other techniques, no? I'll talk about this a bit more. And the thing is that what I want to say now is that if the system B grows, this quantity increases, but it's intuitively this B system growing by locality should not affect what happens on system A, no? Whether you can extract energy acting on system A or not, okay? So we have a numerical example of this, no? So we looked at this 1D chain, this Hamiltonian, and like basically this chain, no? And we extract energy from here, from the leftmost site on the chain. And we were able to plot using the inequality from the necessary and sufficient conditions, actually. What is the critical temperature below which the state is CP local passive, okay? And we have the results here, no? You can see there's some funny stuff happening at n equals 2 and n equals 3 because at this point, the entanglement of the ground state is, I think, is very small. But also you can see that as the system size grows, like basically the curve just doesn't change, right? So this means that whatever happens here doesn't affect much what happens here, no? Yeah, so I think this is intuitive, no? And we actually have a proof of this. And we ended up using a result from quantum algorithms, actually, for this. So the intuition is, the B region can grow large, no? Because what happens in A should not affect much. No, sorry, what happens in far away from A should not affect much, you know, what one can do on A, no? So actually we have a result about this, which is that if the correlation length, so now we're talking about a lattice in a thermal state, no? So imagine this 2D lattice, for instance, no? This is my system, no? And I have my subsystem A, which is the one in which I'm acting to extract energy, right? Okay. So now, if I take this bound, right, this has some quantities E. Well, this has all these quantities, no? And these quantities have to do with the whole system, right? And because of this, this number here is going to grow very fast, no? It's going to grow with system size, right? But what we can show, actually, and for this we use this result of Brandão and Castoriano, which is actually a paper on quantum algorithms for thermal states, is that actually what you can do is you can just, instead of looking at the whole system, you can look at a sublattice, which contains A, right? And then apply the bound to this sublattice, right? And the size of this region, you know, can be like relatively small, no? How small depends on the correlations on your thermal state, no? So what happens when you do this is that you have the same bound, but you have an extra error. And this error depends on this lambda, which actually has to do with how the correlations decay in the thermal state, no? So this lambda is basically this number here. It's given by this number, no? So you have your lattice, and you have this covariance of different observables and different points in the lattice. So X and Y are observables separated by distance L, okay? And what this is saying is that this covariance decreases as lambda of L, no? So usually this number is going to be an exponentially decreasing function, no? So this is exponentially decreasing, and L here is the width of B1, okay? So if you make B1 large enough, this quantity is going to be basically 1. So it's not going to affect the bound very much. And now this bound, the quantities in this bound are calculated with respect to B1 and A only, okay? So with this, basically we're showing that, you know, locality matters here, no? Like long range properties, like if your correlations are small, long range properties don't matter for this phenomenon, no? That's the point we wanted to get across, no? Okay. What else? Okay. So yeah, so we've talked in the past few minutes about sufficient conditions, no? So I was showing, basically I was showing this bound, no? So this bound, of course, is not a necessary condition, it's a sufficient condition, no? If this bound holds, then the state is CP local passive. If it doesn't hold, then you don't know anything, right? And in fact, we have some simple numerical experiments that tell you that this bound is, I mean, it's far from necessary. So in fact, well, CP local passivity can appear beyond this bound, no? In fact, you don't necessarily need a unique or entangled ground state. You don't even need a state that is diagonal in the energy eigen basis. We have examples of all these things, no? Intuitively, you are going to need entanglement in the maybe not in the ground state, but somewhere in the close to the ground state, no? But this is just an intuition, no? We have some examples, but they're very simple, no? So I guess the message I want to get across is that we have some sufficient conditions, but actually I think it would be interesting to, and there's a lot more room for exploring further sufficient conditions, no? So we were able to prove this bound, and it's sort of it was like a bit done with like brute force, no? I think there's a lot of room for improvement here, no? And basically, improvement for what? For finding more sufficient conditions, which basically means more physical conditions under which this CP local passivity holds, no? And the reason for this is that, you know, the necessary and sufficient conditions give you all the information you need, but it's hard to understand physically what this information is, no? So sufficient conditions that give you physical intuition are maybe relevant in this setting, no? So I guess what I want to say with this is that there's actually a lot of room for like exploring this phenomenon further, no? So I will invite you to look at this, and we can also talk about it more like by email or something if you're interested. I guess I want to conclude with one last point of discussion, which has to do with the quantum thermodynamics more in general, no? So what we've seen here in this talk is that there's like this sort of genuinely quantum effect that can hinder the flows of energy in certain directions, no? And under certain parameter regimes and circumstances, no? So maybe one thing that maybe stems from this is that there's like some sort of quantum disadvantage in certain thermal machines, in some regime of certain thermal machines, no? Of course, the usual narrative is that, you know, and this is like, it makes sense why this is the more interesting question, is when there is a quantum advantage for thermal machines, no? But, you know, I guess maybe there's other cases that, you know, this is hinting at something like this, maybe there's other cases in which there's some sort of quantum disadvantage, no? I don't know. I think this is yet to be seen, no? But maybe let me explain a bit more what I mean with this picture and what I mean with the connection between this phenomenon and the thermal machines. So this is the same picture again. So how does CP local passivity come in here? I guess this picture is deliberately written as close to the setting of like a Carnot refrigerator, okay? Where this is the cold bath, this is the working body, and there's something here that may be the hot bath, no? So I want to look at these two, no? So CP local passivity is going to be studied in terms of these two subsystems, no? So imagine that I have the first one of the steps of my Carnot refrigeration cycle is that this whole system, the working body and the hot bath, are thermalized together, so they're in a joint thermal state of a low temperature, which is the temperature of the cold bath, no? And in particular, they're strongly coupled, no? So this is like a strongly coupled thermal machine, no? Actually, yeah. That's what I've been saying. So we have the working body, and we have the strong coupling, and we have the cold bath, no? So the point is that if the strong coupling and the temperature are such that this CP local passivity holds, there's no way in which acting on the working body alone, you're going to be able to extract energy outwards from this system, okay? You will have to act also on the cold bath, no? Which is not what usually happens in thermal machines, no? As far as I understand it, no. Usually you will act on the working body, no? And when you want to, you know, when you want to extract energy, no, into the hot bath, no. But again, I'm not an expert on this, so maybe there's some caveats in this picture, and I would actually like to know them. And I know there's one more caveat actually, which I think I shouldn't be glossing over, which is that actually I've been assuming that we only act on H of A, no. But of course, there's something non-local going on here, no? Which is the interaction between A and B, no? So the assumption that I've been making all along is that the CPTP map that acts on here is actually much faster than this interaction, right? Because if the CPTP map is low, then this interaction is also gonna kick in, right? So and the whole effect of the CPTP map may be global, no? So what I'm saying with this is that this CP local passivity is an effect that appears only in a very particular regime. And the question I have, and the question we have not been able to answer, but I think it's worth exploring, is whether this regime is actually a relevant one. No, that's the question I want to pose to everyone. And with this, I want to conclude actually, just with the slide from the beginning. And you know, I think I've more or less gone over all these points. So again, this is the proposal, which is that you know the passivity may be extended to other kinds. You know, I show you the results that basically characterize this notion of CPTP local passivity under basically passivity under local CPTP maps. And we have necessary and sufficient conditions, and we have sufficient conditions. And we use some techniques like semi-definite programming that I think if you end up looking at other kinds of passivity beyond this one, for instance, you can look at other kinds of like local operations like LOCC, no, or like other things, no. Actually, LOCC semi-definite programming is not going to be so useful, but for others it might be actually. Or for instance, you can look at things like you know a type of passivity where you focus on like the free operations of a resource theory, no. Like maybe some of these things are actually physically relevant, no. But the point is that you know there's some room, no, for finding physically relevant kinds of passivity, no, beyond the usual one and maybe also beyond the one I've presented here, no. And again, there's the question I have about thermal machines, no? So I think that's it. And actually, with that, I want to conclude. And thank you all for watching. And here's the archive reference in case you're interested. Thanks a lot.
Thanks very much, Álvaro. Very nice, very clear talk. So we have plenty of time for questions. And I think we already have a few. I'll bring myself back in as well. Mm-hmm. The first question is from Gabriele De Chiara. Hi, Gabriele. So he was asking something, I think, around the point where you were mentioning this work by Fernando Brandão. So I think this question is related to this. He says, is the bound connected to area laws?
This bound actually is not necessarily connected to area laws. So actually, this paper of Brandão and Castoriano, it's about quantum algorithms for thermal states. So it's like, I mean, it's only slightly related to area laws, but the connection is not very direct. So what they do here is that they explore how a certain kind of quantum algorithm having to do with recovery maps can create thermal states. And the thing is that a key property for this algorithm to work is that the correlations decay very fast, and also that you have this property that somehow local thermals, like the marginal of thermal states doesn't care too much about what happens far away. So like if these things work, the algorithm works. So it's not quite related to area loss of ground states, if that's the question.
But it's still related to the same idea of decay, I mean, short range correlations, right?
Yeah, certainly. So the thing is that short range correlations are a condition for the algorithm of this paper to work.
Yeah, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Thank you. The next question, cool question from Giovanni Spaventa, who says, thanks for the talk. I was wondering if it would make sense to define completely CP local passive states in the same way one defines completely passive states, singling out the Gibbs state.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, good question. I think the question makes sense. And actually, I think there's a way to answer this, and I don't know the answer, which is, you know, you can just like look at this condition and this basically at this operator. And you can easily put a tensor product here, no, of like n copies, no, and also the Hamiltonian here, no.
Yeah.
And maybe what you can do is study what happens with this inequality. For instance, I guess the question here would be like, oh, if I have a state which obeys this inequality for one copy, what happens when I increase the number of copies, no?
Yes.
So I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer, but I think I don't know how easy it is to get the answer, but I think there's something to explore here. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Maybe the problem is that maybe the answer is not as neat as for the usual passive case, no? Because we know that completely passive states are thermal states, no? And that's a very interesting statement, no? I don't know if there will be a similarly interesting statement here, but who knows? Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Well, I guess it's interesting because people already knew about the Gibbs state from other things, right? But I mean, then you can argue about what makes them more fundamental. I suppose some people might argue, mathematically speaking, that complete passivity is sort of what defines them, and we just accidentally discovered them through heat engines and so on. Anyway.
So maybe this could define some interesting class of states.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Okay, cool. So please don't hold back with questions, guys. Feel free to ask. So we've got plenty of time. Maybe I can ask something that I was just curious about, which is probably a pretty basic question. But is it always possible to sort of define? Okay, so sorry, maybe I start again. So you phrase this mostly in the context of cooling and then energy extraction. It's clear that's useful because you want to cool something down. But you could also think about it in the other context that people often discuss, which is kind of work extraction from a quantum system, where you sort of really say that the energy that's gone from the quantum system goes somewhere else and is useful. And kind of with ergotropy and with other things like non-equilibrium free energy, there's always some kind of operational interpretation. Would you have an operational interpretation in general for this kind of passivity, which is more general?
Operational interpretation. Okay. So here there's in this context, there's a quantity that is analogous to ergotropy, no? Which is, for instance, this equation is telling you that this, you can understand this quantity, this minimization, as an ergotropy, no?
Yes.
It's just that in the case in which you have CP local passivity, this weird ergotropy is zero, no? So I don't know, is that not already an operational interpretation, or what do you have in mind?
Yeah, no, I guess, in a way it is. I suppose what I was thinking is, I guess with ergotropy, the operational interpretation is somehow that you have some classical field which carries out some transformation cyclically.
And then when
you say I extracted work from the quantum system, what you really mean is I did work on the classical field, or, more precisely, I have a highly energetic quantum system that can be approximated by a classical field, and that extracted some work. Here, obviously, you have more general class of transformations.
So I think this is maybe a bit. Maybe a problem with this is that it's a bit harder to interpret easily in thermodynamic terms, no? Because of course the CPTP map involves it's not just like a classical driving or something. No, it involves like an environment. No, so I guess it's hard to interpret this quantity of work as work exactly. No.
Yeah.
That may be an issue.
Yeah.
I mean, again, maybe one thing I haven't mentioned is that actually, if your state is CP local passive, it's also passive under local unitaries, no? There's a relation between the two things, no? Like this is stronger than being
indeed
passive under local unitaries, no? So maybe you can do something with that fact alone, no?
I see. Yeah. Mm. I mean, and is there any connection with non-equilibrium free energy? Because I always think of it. I mean, that is somehow with an environment, right? That's saying how much work can I get out with an environment instead of just with no environment.
Yeah. Here there's no fixed temperature or anything, right?
So I guess this would include. I mean, okay. Sorry if I keep on banging on about this. I'm just kind of interested in work extraction. But I guess some CP maps could be thought of as ones that have a real thermal environment. But this is much more general. This is more general, I guess. Is that correct?
For instance, that could be another entry here. No, you have a further. You can have, because here we are learning for general CPTP maps. No, you could have another restriction on CPTP maps. No, and in particular, if you can write this as if this set of CPTP maps is like convex, maybe you can write it as a semi-definite program.
Mm-hmm.
And you can apply the same tools. No.
Yeah.
And in that case, yeah. So for instance, you can probably put local thermal operations here, for instance, no?
Yes.
Maybe it's a bit. I'm not sure if semi-definite programming will work here, but but it's a problem you can study, no? And maybe there's some papers about this. I'm not sure. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks very much. That's interesting. Okay. So unless we have any further questions, then maybe we can kind of conclude here. There's a little bit of a delay, but that we already had a few questions. We have lots of people kind of clapping and saying thank you. So I always like to relay that, because obviously you can't see that or hear that, but very much appreciated the talk. I think maybe that's a good place to kind of conclude, because I think I got all the questions. Thanks very much to everyone for tuning in once again, and especially thank you so much, Dr. Álvaro Alhambra, for a really nice clear talk. Thank you.
Thank you.